after session. Amber's going to take a drink. I'm going to take a drink. Then I'm going to step on my soapbox.
We have to hydrate our throats after basically jabbering at you guys for a half an hour.
Right. Okay. It's a great way to start the after session. I know my fan is running at full speed. I know you guys can't see it. Amber can see it. But this thing is like blasting full speed right now.
You can't see mine, but mine's pointed directly at my face. I have a little desk fan.
It's the only way to survive.
Exactly. Oy. I can't imagine. Like, I know that there are cons going on right now.
Yeah.
There are cons going on in Texas right now in this heat wave. There are cons going on right now in Texas with this heat wave with people in full cosplay.
I don't know how they do it.
I don't understand.
I don't get. It means you don't go outside. You need to make sure that you are in a heavily air-conditioned area at all times. And you can't
leave
it.
And even then, you would still want to wear a fairly comfortable and breathable, airy costume. You wouldn't want anything heavy. No ball gowns. You wouldn't want anything that has multiple layers. You wouldn't want anything that's heavily lined and interfaced and faced. You would want something that you can be comfortable in, kind of like your own, you know, t-shirt and shorts or jeans kind of thing at a con, especially when it's that hot outside. Like, even in a t-shirt and jeans, I still roast.
Oh, yeah. And I mean, even back when I was still a newbie to cosplay, like, I already knew at the beginning of time, like, you know, if I'm wearing this big, heavy thing, I am never going outside with it. You cannot pay me to go outside with it because I will roast and melt and then become dehydrated. And then somebody's going to take me to the hospital because I am dehydrated. No thank you whatsoever. So, I mean, I knew back then that how important it was to, like, be conscious of what I'm wearing, when I'm wearing it, and not to overload myself. But if it's like, okay, I really want to wear this one costume at this one con because the interior location looks so good, I'm like, I will only go to that interior location. I will not go outside. I'm wearing this for exactly 1 hour, and then I'm changing so I don't melt. I mean, you got to put limitations on yourself, that's for sure.
You can't even really depend on, you know, the power being on. Or even the air conditioner working at the hotel.
Yes, because that could happen. Sometimes stuff happens and stuff breaks.
It happened a few years ago. I forget whether it was A-Fest or
A-Fest.
Project A-Con when it was back, you know, at the Sheridan.
A-Fest.
But one of the cons at the Sheridan, the air conditioner actually stopped working.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe it ended up being 85 in the hotel. And this is in the hotel with 5,000 other people. In cosplay.
That's hot.
Crowded into hallways. And that also meant that the air conditioning was not working in the hotel rooms either, because I had a room and all you could do is turn on the fan. There was no cold behind it. It was just blowing air. Blowing hot air.
Mm-hmm.
That was 85 degrees.
Gosh.
And all that the hotel could do was tell the attendees, we're working on it. We're working on it. We're working on it. And I mean, to be fair, they were trying to fix it, but it was several hours of just hot Texas humid heat in the hotel because there was no air conditioning. And yet people still went about their way around the convention and still, you know, partied hard.
Yeah. I mean, some people it doesn't faze them. Other people, it's like, nope, I've hit my limit. I'm done. Bye.
I went up to my hotel room and just flopped.
Yeah.
Because there was just nothing I could do.
I just remember that one specifically because I was just like an hour into it. I could feel it. And I was like, I'm gone. And I just got in my car and left because I was like, I just can't handle this.
Yeah, many people did. And I don't blame them. If I hadn't had a room, I probably would have left too.
We depended on the AC.
Yes. In Texas, basically between the months of April and November, we depend on the AC working.
Which I know sounds like such a long gap of time. The problem is that Texas weather is so stinking unpredictable. It's like it could be 75 one day and then 98 the next day. It goes that wild and varies so drastically. Even at the beginning of the year, you have no way of knowing. So it's got to be AC ready at any moment.
We basically get heat waves starting in April and they can last all the way through like end of October, beginning of November before it actually starts somewhat being normal, which
air
is, quote? You know, normal for Texas just means hot for everybody else.
Yeah. We can deal with some heat. It's just when it gets to like that 98 level, you're like, oh, this is a little much.
And you know, when it is that hot outside, please, please, please take care of your hygiene. If you're at a con and it's that hot, you're going to sweat.
You're going to smell. Everybody will smell.
You're going to stink. And so will everybody else. Val mentioned it very eloquently. You will smell. You will stink. Please shower.
I'm so eloquent. This is the after session. It's fine.
I mean, yes, even if you shower, there will be other people that stink. I understand. But it's more of stink less by consensus because you're not adding to the problem.
There you go.
It helps. Trust me.
It really does help. Everybody's
and you feel better
nice.
Too.
Helps.
You feel better at the end of the day. Even if it's a roasting hot day, you feel better after a shower.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
You'll feel refreshed. It doesn't have to be a cold shower. You can still take like a lukewarm shower. Still works.
Just smell better.
Use soap, please.
Just smell speaking better.
Speaking of soap, I understand you have a soapbox.
I have so many soapboxes.
Segway.
Because cosplay Twitter went wacky this week. Oh my good gravy. The first one is, and I'm sticking this in the after session because I didn't think that it would be appropriate to talk about it during the main show. But the first one was, did you hear about Anime Expo?
I did not. Please tell me what happened at Anime Expo.
So, Anime Expo is going to be July 4th weekend, like it always is.
So in about 3 weeks from when we're
recording.
3 weeks
from now. On Wednesday, they announced that they were changing their COVID protocols, basically stripping back everything. And
by stripping back, I take it you mean reducing restrictions?
Absolutely. Because initially it was you're supposed to be fully vaccinated. You had to bring in your vaccine card because you're going to be checked. You had to be negative test before you're allowed in and required to wear a mask at all times. They basically reduced it to you can wear a mask, but it may not get enforced.
So it's recommended.
Recommended. Needless to say, a lot of people got very angry at them very, very quickly, especially a lot of their international guests.
Understandable.
Which have much harsher COVID restrictions than we currently do in the United States. So it basically prevents them from even going to the convention and they would have to cancel their appearance.
Right.
And oh my goodness, I don't think I have seen such a huge outcry against the convention in such a long time. And I'm glad that they did it for the right reasons. But people were like, here's who you need to contact. Here's what you need to do. It's like if you want to file a chargeback, you know, chargeback should always be a last resort because a lot of times vendors will look at your credit history, unfortunately. And if they see that you've done multiple chargebacks on something, they may prevent you from getting a purchase of something that might be expensive. So be careful with that. But, you know, people were giving, you know, recommendations on how to write the letters to Anime Expo to get them to reverse the decision. A lot of the people in the artist alley were coming up with signs to post on their stations that say, hey, no mask, no service. So, I mean, people were in an uproar for it. And it worked because 24 hours later, Anime Expo reversed their decision and said, well, we're going to keep...
They reversed their reversal.
They reversed the reversal and said, we are going to keep the original COVID guidelines and it's not going to change. So proof that the system works, if you get enough people to argue and say, hey, this is not cool, and you're respectful about it, they will actually listen because they realize they're going to lose a lot of money out of this.
So bear in mind, for those who don't know, Anime Expo is the largest anime convention in the United States. It is larger than Akon. It is larger than SakuraCon and Anime Boston.
Hundreds
of thousands of people.
Literally 100,000 people that they cram into this convention center, and because they still don't have an attendance cap after all of these years.
Right.
Oh my God, I don't think they have an attendance cap this year again.
No, they don't.
So,
and it's also held in California, and part of the reason is it makes it accessible to international fans. So there are tons of people that fly in for this con. It's not just locals. I mean, there are a lot of people that have to travel long distance to get there.
Mm-hmm.
Because not only is it the biggest anime convention, but because of that, they've also got some of the biggest names in cosplay, some of the biggest vendors, some of the biggest
voice actors,
anime, anime publishing companies.
Yeah.
They've got the best of the best at this con, and so people will make plans months and months and months and months, sometimes years in advance, to go. And so having to cancel these plans with, again, 3 weeks' notice.
3 weeks' notice.
You know, some places won't let you cancel that close without penalty.
Especially if you're a dealer or an artist, like, you're locked in. You cannot get refunded at that point.
You have to pay a deposit to hold your table.
So you're
sometimes
out.
Sometimes that's a good chunk of money. And the only way to make that money back would be to sell at the con to basically make enough money to pay your table fee.
Yep.
Well, if you don't go to the con and you've already paid your dealer fee, that's it.
Yeah.
You just ate that money. And for a lot of people, that's how they make a living.
Especially given with the fact that we have really haven't had cons for almost 2 years, they need this for a living. They have to go for a living. So they're stuck. They had to show up. And to spring this on them so soon to the convention is pretty crappy. I know ASEN did it literally 3 days before the con. They dropped all of their COVID restrictions and they did not reverse it. I've heard a lot of cases have popped up since then. Other conventions are doing the same thing too, unfortunately. So guys, keep on top of your cons and make sure you look at their policies, because more and more of them are easing up the restrictions to get more people in to make more money. And
or at least that's their thought process.
That's their thought process, because they're like, oh, hell, I mean, you know, we can get a couple more people in to buy some more passes because they don't need to wear a mask anymore. They're going to be more likely to show up. Keep an eye on the protocols. Make sure that you make screenshots of times and dates. So that way you can just say, hey, here's what I signed up for when I bought a badge. So that way, if you do want to try and get a refund for your badge because the protocols change, like, this is what I agreed to when I purchased my badge, and you changed it. This is a bait and switch. I would like a refund, please.
Right. It's false advertising.
That's very false advertising.
I honestly, if they had kept that, and I would kind of be interested to see if ASEN had any of these same problems, I would worry for the vendors and the artists that basically tried to enforce the no mask, no service thing.
Yeah.
Because while they have the right to do that, it's their table.
It's
they
their table.
As they please. And, you know, I'm in full agreement. If you don't like it, then just don't patronize them. However, there have been instances, and it's been in the media in the United States, where people have gotten quite violent over mask mandates, especially those who are against them. And occasionally they will lash out at those trying to enforce it. And unfortunately, people have been killed because of it. And so, you know, if I were a vendor or an artist there, I would probably be afraid to try and, you know, enforce that kind of personal requirement. It would make things potentially dangerous. And I would think that the con would potentially lose money. At least if, I mean, obviously if they have a dealer or a table fee that you have to pay in advance, obviously they'd have that money.
They have that.
But if, you know, if they have to pay like a percentage of the proceeds to the con, or if the fee is refundable or something, I can see cons losing a serious amount of money if they try and pull something like that, especially so close to the con. Because if you were to change it, say, 3 days in advance, 3 days isn't enough to get a COVID test in a lot of places. It's certainly not enough to go get a vaccination appointment in a lot of places, because there's just not enough vaccines for that. So they being the cons, really need to kind of think twice about how much notice they're giving their attendees to plan. You guys can go back and watch all of our previous episodes about conventioning and all the tips and tricks that it takes to have a successful convention. One of the biggest things we always drive home in every single one of those episodes is planning. Attendees like to plan stuff. Let us plan.
Especially for something like Anime Expo, where the hotels sell out so quickly, you have to plan well far in advance in order to get
access. So do the flights.
Yeah, and the flights and all that stuff. So, I mean, to drop it on them 3 weeks beforehand, I just will say I am grateful that the gods of social media and people were diligent and the thing worked and they reversed the reversal. That is,
Yes.
I'm glad that they did that. How they're going to enforce the masking is going to be quite a spectacle because AX is not known for good crowd control, so.
Even then, and Tamlin notes in the chat as well that another convention had a mask policy, but they didn't enforce. And they won't any more than retail establishments did during pandemic. And the reason for that is one, for liability reasons, and two, because their people don't have the training to deal with what is effectively having to enforce the law. That would be a function of like security or law enforcement.
It would be
And their convention volunteers are usually not that.
yeah, they would have to hire outside staff. I know Fanime did that. They did have very strict COVID protocols for people to enter, and they did hire a ton of extra security specifically to have them stand around and say, mask up, mask up, mask up. And that's what they were doing all weekend long. And I've heard that it ended up working out really, really, really well, even though it was still crowded. But they do have to take the time and they have to have the financing and the money to hire that additional security, which AX does. They got the money for it. We know they do.
Yeah, and it's always better to prevent an incident
Yeah.
than to try and save face afterward because
Right.
the PR is not great.
It's not worth it. The con PR has been in the toilet for a number of years right now. You don't want your event to kind of add to it.
Yeah, and we've had entire after sessions on PR and
Oh
managing
gosh,
PR too.
yes. Absolutely. Absolutely.
All right, next soapbox item.
Next one is from another convention that happened over the weekend is the whole wonderful old situation where somebody in the crowd was like, "Hey, that entry for that cosplay contest should not have won Best in Show." And I am salty about it. So
That
people
happens in every
I
contest.
know, with this time I think this one stood out more than the others is because it's a new cosplay director, it's new people who are hosting these contests and being involved with it. It's kind of like the first year that this con has come back after pandemic stuff and being canceled the last 2 years. This is a little bit more abrasive than what I've seen in the past, in that the person, a couple of people had did this where they took a photo of a person that they wanted to win, and then they took the photo of the person that did win, put them together and said, who do you think should win? This person who did da 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 or this one? And really kind of just like did the weird comparison between the two. And
Yeah.
it just felt so So first
You
off,
know,
please don't do
cosplay con yeah,
that.
cosplay contests are judged by a panel of people that are
Yeah.
chosen for that. They're not judged by social media popularity voting contests for a reason.
Yeah, the judges see things that you as the audience don't get a chance to see. They get to learn the insides and out, literally,
Literally.
of every piece of that costume. And they have to judge the entire scope and scale of everybody from armor to wig work to makeup to special effects to props to sewing and all the stuff in between in order to determine who's going to win and who's not going to win. And it's a challenging thing to do. So to be a bad sport or to be somebody who says, I don't think that that person should win, I'm going to blast them on social media, it's not a good look, one. Two, it's very disrespectful to all of the cosplayers involved, both in and outside of the contest. That's not how they want their work and their hobby to be treated. It's just straight up rude, personally.
Honestly, you can feel that the other person shouldn't have won. That
You're allowed to
is
have that
valid.
feeling.
You're allowed to have your opinion, and that is valid. We're not going to knock you ever for having that feeling. But kind of put the shoe on the other foot. You know, if somebody went into a contest that you won and put an unflattering photo of you up next to a photo that, you know, they thought should have won and put it on blast for, you know, thousands upon thousands of people on social media to see, you probably wouldn't like it very much either.
Yeah. It's not a good look. It's grody. It's just if you genuinely have a problem with the winners of a contest, there are more appropriate outlets to take to express your concerns. Like if you thought something may have been unfair, if you just want a little bit more clarification on why you chose this over that, you can contact the convention. You can talk to the cosplay coordinator if their information is available. Be kind. Please don't be just straight up like blasting them with evil hate messages like, I think so-and-so should have done this and blah, 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 blah. No. Be polite, be respectful, state your position, state your reasoning, and see if you can get some clarification. And heck, if you're at the show and you want to know why the Best in Show won, you could go up to the entries and talk to them and say, hey, I want to learn more about your costume. I'm curious to see, you know, what you did with it, what makes it so great and so unique. I have had this happen to me multiple times because I do sewn garments, and I have had people tell me that I shouldn't have won. I had that happen at my very first event that I won. And people came up to me afterwards and said, can I see what your costume is like? I'm really curious. And once I pointed out all the details, they said, oh, okay.
Sometimes and note that people
it's a misunderstanding.
Note that the people who approached Val did it politely.
Politely, yeah. It
they
wasn't
like...
They
did not get up in her face. Yeah. They did not try and start something.
No, no.
They're not being, you know, aggressive and in your face about it. Yes, they were upset and understandable, valid, still polite.
They were still very respectful about it. They were just like, I'm really curious about your costume. And I was like, yeah, sure, come on, take... I wouldn't do that now because of COVID. I'd be like, here is my online portfolio. But in the olden pre-pandemic days, I mean, I'd be like, yeah, let me just point out all this stuff. And here's the hand embroidery. Here's the stitch. I mean, cosplayers are really cool about that. They're very cool about that, I promise. Yeah.
It's and that's just, something else that people don't see is the portfolio that you bring with you to judging.
Mm-hmm.
The judges like get to see photos of the in process of making the costume. So they, you know, again, literally get to see the insides and the outsides of the costume.
Mm-hmm.
That even the people who are in the front row of the audience on stage can't even see all the details. But the judges do.
Yeah.
Because they got to see it very up close and personal.
I have flipped many, many seams in my time.
Yes. Yes, the seam flipping thing has become a joke, but it's really not a joke.
It's not a joke. We do
it. We actually do it.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yes. Yeah, that became a thing, and it just trended on a scale to the point of that people involved with said convention have said, okay, that's enough. Let's chill. It's being disrespectful and rude to everybody. This is just too much. We gotta, let's calm down and take a step back.
Yep.
The other one that I had was just one that I posted today, which was like, you know, cosplayers do not value comfort.
Comfort. The age-old comfort versus accuracy.
Oh my gosh, because I was just thinking in my head, these are some amazing costumes that I bet some of these people are dying in them. There is something to be said about comfort, and it is totally okay to be comfortable in your costume, especially as you get older and you realize, man, I've done a number on my body over the years for cosplay, and I don't regret it. I kind of hate myself for it, though, because there are certain things that I will never, ever do again because of it. So I'm just like, yeah, I will make sure I can sit, and that I can eat, and I can drink,
yes,
and I can go to the bathroom. And then I can easily swap out my shoes for flats so that I don't have to wear 6-inch stilettos. You know, just common sense things now that I'm like, I will always have pockets. I don't care. I will always have pockets. You better freaking believe it. And a bag. You gotta value, cosplayers need to value comfort because, man, when you want to wear that thing for 8-10 hours a day, you will feel it and you're gonna hate it.
I think if it's for competition, or if it's for a very specific photo shoot, if you want to go for accuracy, that's fine. Just understand the consequences of that.
Mm-hmm.
If you're just going around the convention for casual photos and you're not competing in it, it's so much better on you.
Yeah, on your body.
Both on your body, but also for the process of making it.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's much less complicated and stressful to have to make a comfortable costume, since you're generally omitting things, the more complex things that you would put in for accuracy purposes. But it's also so much better on you mentally going around the convention.
Yeah.
Because you'll have more fun. You'll be more relaxed. And when you're relaxed and comfortable at a con, you enjoy it
more
because you're not, you know, basically in pain.
Yeah.
The whole time sitting in either an uncomfortable position or in an uncomfortable cosplay where you have to basically make modifications on your body instead of the other way around to fit the cosplay.
Yeah. I remember, as you're speaking, I remember the contest that we entered as our Rava and Vatu.
Yes.
And one of my favorite people was entering with her big armor stuff. She actually won an award there too. But at the very end of the contest, she was with her dad. And she said, "Dad, I need to get out of this armor immediately." The armor was strapped into her so tightly. I mean, it was done for accuracy purposes. So he actually brought out the scissors and cut off the lacing of the armor, something that could easily be replaced, not a big deal. I just remember seeing all of those harsh lines on her body that were dug into her skin along her shins and along her arms. And I was just thinking, oh, poor baby, you're going to have those for days. And I bet they sting, but I bet it also feels amazing to have that armor off right now. I'm just like,
oh, yeah,
that accuracy ain't worth it.
I still have a permanent scar from the battery pack burning me from one of my costumes.
Yeah.
Because I had to make it light up for accuracy purposes because it was a magic weapon. Not worth in
hindsight.
Not worth.
My feet will never be the same. Thank you, cosplay. Like, I thought I'd broken them through ballet and gymnastics. Oh, cosplay made it worse.
And it's not just shoes. There are many places in a costume where you can make it more comfortable.
Yeah.
In fact, I think the very first time that I taught a sewing panel at Akon, Sewing 101, way back in the day, there's still footage of that, by the way. I'm not fond of it. But one of the first things that I teach in the class is body measurements. And I emphasize to the audience, don't skimp on your measurements. Mm. Don't alter your measurements to make yourself look smaller, because you want to be able to literally breathe properly in your costume. You want to be comfortable. If you cannot take a full breath in your costume, that is not the costume for you. And that is my own opinion. Obviously, you know, that's not factual. That's just how I feel. But if you cannot literally breathe, do not wear. That's it.
Yeah. It's like all
it's
of those.
Not worth.
It's not worth it. It's like all of those really bad movies and historical dramas where they stick women in the tight, tight, tight lacing corsets to the point where they can't breathe. Yes. That is so not accurate. Please don't do that to yourself. You need to be able to breathe.
Yeah. I mean, back in the day, I'm sure the women actually did that.
Some
where
did.
They were so tight where they literally like couldn't properly, not that they couldn't breathe, just not properly.
Some did it, and there are consequences for that. The vast majority of people, if you wear a corset properly, you can breathe just fine.
Right.
It's you gotta make sure that it's the proper fitting one. That's how you know it's ill-fitting, is if you have to lace it up so tightly that to make the proportions work for your body, you can't breathe. Mm-hmm. That's the wrong corset. You got the wrong size.
It's kind of a similar concept with ace bandages,
yeah.
Which if you're doing crossplay for any reason, or if you're cosplaying somebody who may have a differently proportioned body, please do not use ace bandages to wrap yourself, nor duct tape. I have heard about duct tape.
Ow.
One, it is painful, and two, it does not expand, which is a problem when you're trying to breathe. But two, ace bandages are specifically designed to constrict over time. Mm-hmm. That's the reason why you wrap injured limbs with it, is to provide support, tight support to said injured limb, so it does not move. It does that by constricting. Well, if you try and wrap your chest with it, it's going to do the same thing that it's designed to do, and that's going to make it harder for you to breathe. And that can actually like cause you to pass out.
Yeah,
please,
that's
don't.
Really bad for you. Comfort
see the
is important.
Serious face, not laughing. Do not use. I have personally used ace bandages in the past as a cosplayer. No more. Never again. And I will tell everybody else that wants to do the same thing, don't. It is not safe.
Invest in the proper compression shirts and binding shirts. They have tons on the market now. You have no excuse.
Yeah, I mean, there's standard compression sportswear for women. You can go to any major retailer that sells clothing and they will have it.
And they will have it.
Yeah, it's not hard to find.
Yeah.
And it's not expensive either. You can get it for like 10 bucks.
Yeah. They're literally available just about anywhere.
Yeah. Yeah. Go get the thing that's actually designed to do what you're trying to do.
These bandages ain't cheap anymore anyway, so there you go.
Nothing's cheap anymore.
Ha ha!
But all in all, yes.
Comfort!
You will learn over time as you get experience, since we were talking like at the start of the episode about experience in conventions and cosplay. Over time, you learn where the sales are, you learn where the good places are.
Yeah.
You also learn how to do it comfortably.
Yeah, because that's important.
And the comfort kind of starts taking more and more precedence over accuracy after a while.
Absolutely.
People will still recognize you, I promise. As long as your cosplay is close, they'll know who you are, as long as they know like the series and the character. They'll know who you are.
You know, there might be a couple extra seams. It might be a pocket that magically appears. You know, your shoes might not be 6 inches. They may be 1 inch. Are you happy with your costume? Are you enjoying it? Are you comfortable? Can you wear it all day and not be crying in pain at the end of it? Do it. Have fun.
Yep. Do you absolutely have to have zero seams? No. Do you absolutely have to tailor that particular garment, like, touching your body? No. You can add an extra inch of ease on either side. Perfectly fine. It's not going to hurt the costume, nor will it hurt you, and that's the more important thing.
Exactly. So there you go. That's all the stuff going on Twitter. Just in the last, like, 3 days. It's only 3 days.
Only
3 days.
That leaves the rest of the weekend for stuff to happen.
2 more days, a Saturday and a Sunday of madness. Hopefully nothing else crops up. That's for sure.
Well, for those who are going to conventions, please be safe.
Please.
You know, be comfortable where you can. Hydrate where you can. Shower, please. Take it easy when you need to. There's no shame in that. If you need to take a sit down for 15 minutes,
please do.
Perfectly cool.
Do that.
Please do. If you need medical assistance, if you feel like you're going to pass out, please put yourself out there and ask for help. There's no shame in any of that. Like, the whole point of you is to have fun. And if you are sick and not feeling well for whatever reason, you're not going to have much fun. I can promise you that.
Mm-hmm. Anything else to add, Amber?
No, I am good. Anything else on your end?
I am good, too.
All right. Well, if you would like to join in the conversation and let us know what your favorite tips are for making cosplays comfortable or the convention experience in general, feel free to join in the conversation via any of our social media, which, of course, you can find here.
In the corner underneath Amber. And since this is the YouTube-only version, I don't have to tell you all that info. You can just look at it. There you go.
Or, of course, you can email us, podcast@cospod.org, where you will get an answer from each one of us along with a Nick Cage meme.
Perfecto.
I'm sure his costumes are comfortable.
Oh, I'm sure.
Otherwise, please stay safe, stay healthy out there, keep working on those cosplays so that we can all see your friendly, smiling faces at our favorite local convention near you ASAP. Otherwise, we will see you guys next time in episode 257. Happy cosplaying, everybody. Bye-bye.
Bye, guys.